I'm covering life and death issues, serious tragedies, serious momentous occurrences here in Israel and of course in Gaza. And of course, we have to interrupt this for one moment to cover the complete and utter clown car that is the House Republican Speaker's race back in Washington, D.C.
Well, good news, Jake. All the clowns have finally exited the car and we can stop talking about it because this morning the House Republicans decidedly voted Representative Mike Johnson. Yes, that is his real name, not a fake name he gave to trick a substitute teacher into saying Mike Johnson. They decided that he will be the new Speaker of the House following weeks of chaos. Take a look.
As we were listening to the President of the United States, the House of Representatives made it official. There is a new Speaker of the House of Representatives, Representative Mike Johnson of Louisiana, 51 years old. He will become the next Speaker of the House. The Republicans finally, after all these weeks, managed to get their act together and do this. None of the Republicans were earlier opposed a Republican nominee for Speaker. None voted against Mike Johnson this time. He will become the next Speaker of the House.
All right, let's get into some details about this absolute circus that the Republicans have been somewhat entertaining us with over the past few weeks. So officially last night, Representative Mike Johnson became the fourth and as we now know, final Republican nominee for House Speaker and a late night secret ballot after nominee House Majority Whip Tom Emmer dropped out. Now this was a result of holdouts from Trump allies and backlash from Donald Trump himself. So a large fraction of the House conference took issue with Emmer because he was one of the two GOP speaker candidates who voted to certify the results of the election. Yes, it disqualifies you to be the Speaker of the House within the Republican Party if you didn't try to destroy democracy in our country as we know it. Also because he rebuked the January 6th Capitol riots. So if you didn't support that, again, something that disqualifies you in the eyes of Republicans. And he's also been vocal about his criticism of Donald Trump, which we all know is a no-go within the Republican Party as well. Probably the worst offense you could ever commit as a Republican. Now, back to Mike Johnson. If you are not if you don't have a degenerate relationship with C-SPAN like I do, or if you don't cover politics for a living, he's someone who might have flown under your radar. But Brett Ehrlich pointed this out today on Twitter, so I want to talk about this for a second. He said, if you watch the press conferences being led by the Matt Gaetzes, by Marjorie Taylor Greene, by the Lauren Boberts, Mike Johnson is always in the background with a sly smirk. If you go back and watch all of their press conferences, he's always there, and that's because they share a political ideology. Now, newly elected Speaker Mike Johnson, and every time I say his name, I want to laugh a little bit, is one of the staunchest religious conservatives in the House of Representatives. Now, his views align more with Trump and other MAGA Republicans politically and religiously. And let's get into some reporting from the New York Times on Mr. Johnson. An evangelical Christian, he has voted for a national abortion ban and co-sponsored a 20-week abortion ban, earning him an A+ rating from the anti-abortion group Susan B. Anthony Pro-Life America. Continues on, last year, Mr. Johnson introduced a bill that prohibited the use of federal funds for providing sex education to children under 10 that included any LGBTQ topics, a proposal that critics called a national version of Florida's Don't Say Gay law. Mr. Johnson called the legislation common sense. Now, his version of common sense is equating the existence of gay and trans people with hardcore pornography. That is something that he actually believes and has tried to legislate, just to completely erase the existence of gay people in any form from education. As I mentioned, literally equating it with hardcore pornography, a book where a character has, you know, two gay parents, the same as pornography in the eyes of Mr. Mike Johnson. Now, he's also opposed legislation to mandate federal recognition for same-sex marriages, a bill that passed with strong bipartisan support in both the House and the Senate. Now, he's also opposed to sending aid to Ukraine. And of course, he wants to end Social Security and Medicare. Take a look.
I think you and I would agree that individual freedom and limited government are, you know, opposite sides of the same coin. Right. It's difficult as somebody dedicated to principles of limited government to see the ballooning out of the deficit and a complete abandonment of entitlement reform. Your thoughts? We'll start with Mike and we'll go to Mark.
We have to get back to it as a number one priority. The CBO says that entitlement spending, which they define as Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, interest on the debt, right? Those four obligations, we eclipse GDP in what, a dozen years or something. I mean, this is not, this can no longer be kicked down the road. You can't wait 8 years to address this. It has to happen yesterday. So we have to have our hand at the wheel and do this. We are completely derelict in our duty. We're rearranging furniture on the Titanic if we don't get this problem under control.
Statements like that and holding that position should disqualify you from holding public office in this country, let alone being able to hold those views and ascend to Speaker of the House. Now, of course, those aren't his only problematic views. He was also a key player in attempting to overturn the 2020 election. So a little more on that from NBC News. Johnson, who currently serves as the GOP caucus vice chair and is an ally of Trump, led the amicus brief signed by more than 100 House Republicans in support of a Texas lawsuit seeking to invalidate the 2020 election results in four swing states won by Biden: Georgia, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. The lawsuit filed by Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton, a Republican, one of the most corrupt attorney generals in this country, called on the Supreme Court to delay the electoral vote in the four states in order for investigations on voting issues to continue amid Trump's refusal to concede his loss. Now, it alleged the four states changed their voting rules without their legislators' express approval before the 2020 election, and Johnson acted as a messenger for Trump, sending an email to his GOP colleagues to file an amicus brief. So a little more from that same report. The lawsuit swiftly drew backlash from battleground state attorneys general, who decried it as a publicity stunt full of false and irresponsible allegations. Legal experts also pointed to a series of hurdles the lawsuit had faced, saying that Texas lacked the authority to claim that officials in other states failed to follow the rules set by their legislators. Now, despite his views, Johnson didn't really have much to offer as the nominee, and that's exactly why they picked him.
The criteria for becoming speaker was multiple issues, and one was experience. Another was raising money for your colleagues so that they felt that they could give something back in return, namely a vote for speaker. And the ability to lead, to be a proven leader. And Meg Johnson has none of those things, has none of those qualities and none of those characteristics. He's relatively new. And in this particular environment, Wolf, that was the biggest plus for him. That was it. It's that he doesn't have a lot of personal baggage and that he doesn't have the connections, because in this environment, the connections that leaders have made have only made enemies out of a lot of the people in their own conference. And that really speaks volumes, Wolf, about where the House Republican conference is, and frankly, where the Republican Party is.
We've got a little bit more on the absolute ridiculous press conference that was held last night, and which I think demonstrates the state of the modern Republican Party. But first, Cenk, I want to get your thoughts on Mike Johnson, real name.
So I think that that's exactly right. This gives you an excellent sense of where the modern Republican Party is, which is off a cliff. And so the press is beginning to get it, but I think that there's a huge portion of the country doesn't understand that these guys are backwards, undemocratic, un-American, and just mentally unbalanced. Okay, so let me give you more on Mike Johnson and what kind of a radical he is. He has said that homosexuality is inherently unnatural, that it is a dangerous lifestyle, and that it could topple, quote, the entire democratic system. I don't know if he knows this, but there's been homosexuality in this country from the very first day that it was formed, yet here we stand. No, Mike, it's not gay folks who are going to topple the democratic system. It's you. You literally tried to topple the democratic system in 2020. And by the way, he's just full blown lunatic. He was one of the guys like Sidney Powell who was making the case that Hugo Chavez was the one that fixed the election in favor of Biden. Hugo Chavez at that point had been dead for 7 years. So there are no moderate Republican politicians left. The last one, I guess, was Mitt Romney, and he retired in a blaze of glory, you know. And there's nothing left. There's no like, oh, the Republicans will come back to their senses and all this crap and the marketing that Joe Biden does for them and Nancy Pelosi does for them and all the Democrats do for them. Oh, the fever's gonna break and my reasonable friends are gonna come back and we're gonna do wonderful corporate deals and all of our donors, I mean, our voters are going to be happy. No. There's nothing left. These guys are crazy. They're lunatics. So you're gonna see in a second, they catch feelings whenever you ask them about the 2020 election. Why do they catch feelings? They don't wanna answer that under any circumstance. Because if they tell their voters, no, of course Biden won. Of course we're lying. Of course we're lying. Then they'll lose all their base voters and they'll lose their primaries. But if they go around acting like the lunatics that they actually are, and they're like, oh yeah, I think, like drooling, it's Hugo Chavez, man, and the crackers and the mules, man, they stole the election. I don't have any evidence, but you know, I just think that the election was stolen. Well, then they're gonna, a lot of them are gonna lose in general elections because, you know, about a big enough percentage of the country thinks that that's nuts. At least 60% of the country thinks that's nuts. So they can't admit that they're nuts. They can't admit that they're not nuts. So they're stuck picking guys like Mike Johnson, who said, well, if you legalize gay marriage, obviously pedophilia will be legalized next, and bestiality and all of those things. And Yahweh says that we should hate gay people and we should hate Social Security and Medicare. Oh no, right, that's what my corporate donors say. So he's literally the worst of all worlds. He's the worst of the corporate Republicans in that he wants to take away your Social Security and Medicare. He's the worst of the MAGA world in that he led the charge. He's the one that helped to file the suit with that insane fake elector scheme. He's a traitor to this country. And I don't say that in a Republican way where I call for violence or nothing. No, these guys should have all been tried. They should all be prosecuted for trying to do a coup against this country. So instead, he's going to be rewarded with Speaker of the House and is now third in line for the presidency. And to the point that we're both making, one of our members said it in a succinct way, Dragon with a Girl Tattoo wrote in, an election denier that wants to end Medicare and Social Security and take away reproductive rights. Perfect fit. But he is. So don't be like, oh my God, I can't believe the Republicans, what a fluke of luck. They picked the most radical guy in every direction. No, he's perfectly representative of how deeply radical and insane the current Republican Party is.
It's funny because if he actually believed that homosexuality was going to crumble democracy, then he would have been at the front of the Pride Parade waving the rainbow flag, considering he did everything he possibly could to undermine democracy in this country. I mean, if all he had to do was have gay sex, it would have been a lot easier than filing all those amicus briefs. But let's get into how this press conference went for him and what it shows about the Republican Party. Because after his nomination last night, they held this press conference and it raises some concerns for how they're going to continue to handle the press and questioning moving forward. Because ABC News correspondent Rachel Scott decided to ask Johnson about his involvement in Trump's attempts to overturn the election and was met with a lot of hostility. Let's watch.
Mr. Johnson, you helped lead the efforts to overturn the 2020 election results. Will you just continue?
Next question.
Republicans booed and Johnson tried to move on. The House has been at a standstill for 3 weeks without a speaker. As war rages in the Middle East, the president asking Congress to provide $100 billion in aid to Israel and Ukraine. I tried asking Johnson, who would be second in line to the presidency, about that too. He didn't want to talk about it.
You support additional aid to Ukraine?
You've asked your question.
You asked your question. Go away.
We're not doing policy tonight. Any other questions?
Boo, boo, and shut up, repeatedly yelling shut up from the Republicans there. And at the end, he says, we're not gonna talk policy tonight, which is funny because I don't think they're gonna talk policy ever. considering how long this speakership debacle has gone on, and none of it was ideological. None of the battles happening within the Republican Party have been ideological. It's just been a, you know, an attempt at a shameless power grab by, you know, the people who are able to more align themselves with Donald Trump because they represent R+6,000 districts that they're gonna win with ease every time around, like Matt Gaetz, like Marjorie Taylor Greene. And so for me, this whole thing has been such a joke because they had in the speakership Kevin McCarthy, who we routinely and correctly called spineless, and they just had to find an absolute jellyfish to replace him because even the most spineless member of their party was not spineless enough for them. They needed to find someone more shameless to replace him.
Yeah. So first of all, look at these thug dictator wannabe guys. A member of the press asked him the most perfectly reasonable question. You filed a brief saying that Joe Biden didn't win the election. That seems like a massively important issue now that you're third in line for the presidency, among other things. So what do you think? And their answer is boo, shut up, right? Because they don't want to take real questions from reporters. And they're not hiding it. Look at them. They're like, how dare you ask me a legitimate question? We hate the press. We hate democracy. We're not going to do any of it, okay? And so the press should not take that lying down. Every question to every Republican should be, look, let's make it clear. Did Joe Biden win the election or didn't he? I put him on a spot because they're all trying to squirm out of it like the little weasels that they are. And Democrats, stop treating them like they're a legitimate party. Party of people who just escaped an asylum. Come on. Okay, so now, if you're Mike Johnson and you filed that brief and you were worried that Hugo Chavez and his ghost and the Holy Ghost were all gonna steal it on behalf of the pedophiles or whatever insane thing that goes in your mind, well, then aren't you proud that you filed it and you were gonna defend Donald Trump and you were gonna defend democracy? Why wouldn't you be proud of it? Why is that a hard question? So are you proud of it or aren't you proud of it? And if you're a MAGA guy and you think the election was stolen, why isn't Mike Johnson answering this question? Why is he being a coward? Why, is he embarrassed to be on your side? These are very normal questions. And the press should not tolerate these politicians booing them and telling them to shut up. They should double down, quadruple down, and not let him get away with it. But okay, so now they're back. They have a leader, Mike Johnson. He's just as bit radical as every member of that caucus, which has totally lost its mind. People are like, oh, Matt Gaetz is the radical. The rest of them are the moderates. Are you insane? Look at the guy that they just picked. They're all radical. If you're a Republican at the national level and you're a politician, you're in the House or even in the Senate. No, you're radicals, lunatics. Obvious. I mean, are we supposed to debate whether homosexuals are gonna destroy democracy? Are we supposed to debate whether Donald Trump won the election without a single piece of evidence to that effect? Are we supposed to debate the mules and the krakens? What do we do with a party that has completely lost its mind and is thinking their only goals are what? Okay, now they're in charge. What are they gonna do? We're gonna cut Social Security and Medicare and the poor rich. The IRS agents are looking into their fraud. How will they keep their Bentleys and their Ferraris? Protect the rich, attack the average American, and be a lunatic. The current Republican Party slogan.
If I can just end by saying that you're exactly right, that every single Republican is a radical. All of the Republicans of the House are radicals. But there are radical Republicans in purple districts who have difficult re-elections coming up. And by allowing the circus to continue on as long as it did, by giving Matt Gaetz the amount of power, him and, you know, just seven other members of Congress who have safe seats, who don't have to worry about their re-election campaigns, by giving them a lot of power, and then by putting as the most visible Republican in the House, by giving Mike Johnson the speakership, they have absolutely screwed themselves when it comes to those Republicans running in those purple districts. So I think it'll be really interesting to watch how those races play out.
Hey, thanks for watching the video. We really appreciate it, guys. And we appreciate it if you become members because that allows us to be independent, honest, progressive, all the things that you don't get from corporate media. And all of that is because of you guys. Hit the join button below and become one of us, become a Young Turk.